Niklaus Stoecklin was born into a middle-class family in Basel, Switzerland in 1896. His father was a merchant, but his grandfather was an entomologist and illustrator. And Niklaus demonstrated similar inclinations from an early age and drew the natural world throughout childhood. He began his formal art education in 1914 in Munich, and in that year he also created his first poster when he was just 18 years old. But only a few months later the Great War began and he headed back to Basel, where he served briefly in the Swiss Army. He subsequently enrolled at the City's Academy of Fine Arts, but also studied with his uncle, the painter Heinrich Müller. At this time it seemed that it was art which dominated his output, and he had his first solo exhibition of paintings and prints while still a student. In 1920 he created this mural to decorate the wall of the Civil Registry Office in Basel. And both his oil-painted and lithographic art earned him a reputation for the creation of unsettling surrealist images. But not long after, he began a professional association with the Wassermann Print and Publishing Company, and he designed the first of what would be a spectacular volume of posters which would dominate his output throughout his working life. From the outset, Stoecklin was conspicuously diverse in his approaches to image making, and in the early 1920s he produced a series of posters ranging from pure flat graphics through to more painterly solutions, all of which demonstrated complete technical accomplishment and an unerring understanding of how to elicit an appropriate response from the viewer, from light humour through to serious socio-political awareness. He married in 1922, and a year later his wife gave birth to a daughter, their only child. As the decade continues, he became ever more prevalent and popular, and the levels of stylistic disparity he employed in his work went on to even greater levels than his earliest output, demonstrating an ability to absorb and reimagine everything from plausibly oriental styling through to equally credible medievalist woodcut. And every time he occasionally could be said to be settling on a particular graphic or painted style, he would immediately confound that expectation with something else entirely. Whatever he created, like virtually all his poster-making contemporaries, he first produced a rough design using gouache paint, which nevertheless contained all the proposed visual material for client approval, before proceeding to create the artwork for the poster used for publication, as in this example from 1925. Alongside this considerable volume of commercial work, he continued to work as an artist, creating mostly oil paintings, which themselves were rarely the same way twice. But he also worked in watercolour and created prints as traditional lithographs, and in all these formats he also occasionally exhibited the same sly humour and surrealism seen frequently in his posters. In 1926 and 1927, Stoecklin spent time travelling in Tunisia, but it doesn't seem to have affected the amount or quality of his posters at all. How he managed this, I have no idea, and in the later stages of the decade, there seemed to be no stopping his extraordinary volume of creative output, which roamed freely across a range of mediums including watercolour, tempera, graphite, ink, traditional lithography, and anything else he could lay his hands on. Some of his more abstracted flat images were originally created as lino cuts, and he was known to also be an early exponent of the mechanical airbrush when he wanted particularly smooth tonal transitions and high levels of representation. But however he created the originals, they were printed by Wassermann's as lithographs. I have been unable to discover to what extent he was involved in the production of the actual lithographic poster, but I can only hazard a guess that a man of such creative drive would have had to at least take a supervisory or even more hands-on role. One of the more fascinating aspects of his posters was the tendency towards surrealist imagery. Stoecklin was far from the first to utilise surreal elements in his illustrations, and he was in this regard following in a tradition established by earlier poster artists to create an imaginative and indelible image in the viewer's mind. But this was only one facet of a dazzling array of styles and techniques evident in his work, and had they not been signed, I would not have guessed that many of them were actually by him. Despite his success as a poster designer, and perhaps even assisted by the public profile his posters generated, he continued to have a successful parallel career as an artist, and in the later 1920s, he exhibited successfully a couple of times in Basel. The 1930s followed the same pattern, which is to say no discernible pattern at all. Every commission was approached from a different angle, and always with the clear objective of supporting the idea that the client needed to make the maximum impact with whoever they were hoping to target. Perhaps the only unifying factors in all of these images was the unbridled creativity and imagination, and the predominant use of the single element, whether human or inanimate. Among other work at this time, he painted this medicinal plants mural in the Basel headquarters of the pharmaceutical company Roche in 1936. And in the same year, he produced what seems to be a solitary example of an educational illustration for display on school classroom walls. In the later 1930s, there's evidence of a growing interest in wildlife painting in watercolours, which at this stage formed another aspect of his work as an artist. But posters still dominated, and as the 40s began, the posters he produced could finally be said to have derived in the main from the same inspirational and stylistic source. They all revealed the pronounced influence of the early 20th century object poster approach pioneered by German poster artist Lucien Bernhard and his contemporaries. But where their work had been largely flat and usually, but not exclusively, heavily posterized, Stoecklin's images were more painterly and featured an enhanced realism which made them oddly compelling and even enigmatic to the viewer. There was still the occasional surrealist component to some of these designs, but they primarily relied on pure aesthetics to produce an image which would stay in the memory of the man or woman on the street. Consequently, in the 1940s, his poster work lost some of its stylistic diversity, although even then not entirely, and Stoecklin's painted glorification of the object became a dominant theme. He produced a string of impossible-to-ignore dynamically composed images, which held up these frequently mundane products as things worthy of admiration, and therefore attractive to the potential buyer. And the posters remain an enduring validation of simplicity and directness in poster design. This essentially visual message, other than the product name, was aided by the fact that text was kept to an absolute minimum, as the Swiss have four separate languages. In 1943, he also published a book of watercolours of flora and fauna, titled The Beauties of Nature, which contained a collection of illustrations of wildlife at the smaller and less exotic end of the potential spectrum, along with depictions of plants and flowers in a similar botanical watercolour style. These remarkably well-observed and rendered images had no agenda other than to be faithful evocations of the natural world, and as such were perhaps a perfect antidote to the carnage and mayhem that was raging throughout Europe and beyond in the form of World War II. As a neutral nation, Switzerland felt only minimal reverberations from the conflict, and following this success, Stoecklin returned immediately to the production of yet more posters. And although the single entity or small-scale still life mentality ruled the day, there were nevertheless continuing, if occasional, forays into other graphic styling. In the later 1940s and throughout the 1950s, Stoecklin remained a ubiquitous presence, both as an artist and as a designer of posters. And he also took a position as a professor at the School of Design in Basel, passing on his knowledge and considerable experience to a younger generation of graphic artists and designers. Naturally enough, this impacted on his own output, which reduced somewhat in this period. By the later years of the 1950s, he increasingly turned to artistic expression. Whether this was a response to the dramatic increase in the use of photographic images in advertising and consequent lack of opportunity for illustrators, or that he had tired of commercial work, I don't know. But although the volume of his posters declined dramatically, the quality of his technique and imagination did not. And the visual evidence clearly showed that he remained determined to be as graphically diverse as possible. Even when creating images for the same client, he varied his techniques with the same formidable abilities which had led to his unparalleled success as a poster designer half a century earlier. The last dated poster I found by Stoecklin was from 1971, although there may well be other examples which I simply couldn't track down. And he certainly continued to create watercolours of the natural world in the years that followed. But after a remarkable and remarkably varied creative career, Niklaus Stoecklin died in 1982 at the age of 86. Alongside the sheer aesthetic sensibility, versatility and technical dexterity on display in the work of Niklaus Stoecklin, one of his more agreeable and not often found characteristics was that he obviously considered both his art and his commercial illustration as two equal components of his creative impulse. Where others considered themselves to be cursed with having to create commercial work as their art wasn't as popular as they'd hoped, it seems Stoecklin had no such prejudice. And although contemporary advertising is viewed with disdain and mistrust by many, and with some justification, when you see what it used to be at its best in the work of a creative imagination such as Stoecklin's, it's hard not to think we are currently settling for considerably less than second best.